You're listening to the Corbett Report.
Even the most casual observers of the news will have noticed the increasingly bellicose military rhetoric and provocations emerging from both China and the U.S. over control of the Asia-Pacific.
China's defense ministry spokesman Yang Yujun said today that some countries, quote-unquote, were making tensions in the Asia-Pacific worse.
The United States confirmed that it flew two B-52 bombers over China's newly established air defense zone, as well as the disputed Diaoyu Islands.
China has sent fighter jets to its newly declared air zone in the East China Sea. Beijing says the jets flew into the air defense identification zone to strengthen monitoring on targets in the area.
But behind this conflict is another narrative, one of cooperation, agreements, political coordination, and business arrangements that have created a close tie between China and the U.S.
A commitment to cooperation. General Fan Changlong, the vice chairman of China's Central Military Commission, and American General Raymond Odierno oversee the signing of an army-to-army agreement on Friday. The deal, they say, will help improve coordination on a number of issues, like humanitarian relief, disaster response, and the fight against terrorism.
Military-to-military exchanges between the two sides have seen some progress in the past year, as the two sides committed to a new model of military relations.
This is the second time the trilateral exercise has taken place, this year involving 30 soldiers and Marines working closely together in the hot and dry Northern Territory wild. The 30 military personnel include 10 from the Australian Army, 10 from the Chinese People's Liberation Army, 5 from the U.S. Army, and 5 from the U.S. Marine Corps.
What is the truth behind this story of conflict and cooperation? Is this a genuine rivalry, a smokescreen being used to distract the public, or a little bit of both? Michel Chossudovsky of the Center for Research on Globalization explains.
China is, in some regards, an industrial colony. I use that quote unquote, but at the same time, it is an upcoming power on the global stage. And I should mention that that emerged also in the wake of the Cold War, where China's alignments. Vis-a-vis the Russian Federation had changed dramatically to what they were during the Cold War era. And in the late 90s, particularly in the wake of the death of Deng Xiaoping and the demise of the change of government in the Russian Federation. In other words, when Vladimir Putin became president, there we have a consolidation of an alliance between the Russian Federation and the People's Republic of China, the development of the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement, and so on and so forth. And another very important dimension in the late 90s. Ironically, just after Deng Xiaoping passed, there's an increased confrontation in the Taiwan Straits. Of course, there was always confrontation in the Taiwan Straits, but then it was at that point that China developed its military cooperation agreements with Russia. Started to build up a naval facilities in the South China Sea to counteract U.S. threats. And then, of course, we had a very major shift in geopolitical relations, I would say, as of the late 90s, early 2000, early 21st century, which is increasingly towards confrontation between China and the United States. But I should qualify that, because when you go to China, you have a very pro-American intelligentsia, the people in the universities and so on, the School of Journalism of Tsinghua University is supported by Bloomberg. People at the Academy of Social Sciences are very much tied into Western values and so on and so forth. So that, in fact, I would say the leadership is very much divided. America is very visible. Western capital is very visible throughout China, but at the same time, it's more at the political, geopolitical level that there's confrontation. And I think that the Chinese say, well, we're a capitalist economy in our own right. We're not going to be a subordinate colony of the West. But if you look at the actual mechanics of foreign trade, they still are, because they're producing commodities for the world market, and they are sort of feeding the non-productive structures of Western capitalism. If we go back in history, I would say that the West, in a sense, facilitated regime change in China. There's no question about it. It's difficult to research, but Henry Kissinger in 1972, then the Gang of Four and so on, there was a transition towards a reintegration into Western capitalism, okay? And that transition was implemented by a dominant clique within the Communist Party. Now, that clique is still there. There's no question about it. But there are other areas of Chinese society which are firmly anti-American, and certainly within the military. The People's Army, the situation is dramatically different. And at the same time, there's a rather destructive shift in U.S. foreign policy, which is, I think, really motivated by the realignment of China with Russia under the Shanghai Cooperation Agreement. Okay. What they want to do is essentially to break that alliance, and that alliance is, in a sense, is quite fragile, because the United States and Western countries, let's say Western capitalism, but also Japanese capitalism, are fairly well entrenched into the fabric of the banking system in China and so on.
That the United States is uniquely positioned to play a leading role in the Asia Pacific because of our history, our capabilities, and our credibility. People look to us as they have for decades. The most common thing that Asian leaders have said to me in my travels over this last 20 months is, thank you, we're so glad that you're playing an active role in Asia again. Because they look to us to help create the conditions for broad, sustained economic growth and to ensure security by effectively deploying our own military.
The move to create a permanent U.S. military presence in Australia is a show of solidarity and force. When the president said America now has
the presence that's necessary to maintain the security architecture in the region.
What he means is an American troop presence in Japan, South Korea, the Philippines, and soon 2,500 Marines and potentially dozens of U.S. Air Force aircraft in Australia to serve as a counterweight to China.
We are here to stay. This is a region of huge strategic importance to us.
Well, I think that really, if you look at the U.S. standpoint, which is one of world domination, there's a military agenda, there's an economic agenda of dominating the world. And they've succeeded in dominating a large part of the world, where they have their own puppet regimes, their proxy regimes all over, which essentially obey orders and accept the consensus that the United States and its allies are the dominant powers in the world. Now, the Chinese will not do that. That's very, very clear. They won't do that. They're doing it in the way I've described, through joint ventures and this, that, and other, but they're not going to accept a U.S. hegemonic project in in Asia, the Far East. And people who know Chinese history will realize it's called the Middle Kingdom. It establishes its boundaries within within certain realm, they will not accept any kind of territorial encroachment. Now, you're not going to conquer this country in any way, and the question, I think U.S. policymakers want to subdue China. Perhaps they're not doing it the right way. They'll never be able to encroach on their territory in the same way as they encroach on the territory of Iraq or Syria. But having said that, let's bear in mind that there are dirty tricks on the part of the U.S. in supporting insurgencies, of course, in Tibet, it's well understood. They're supporting a separatist insurgency, but they're also supporting insurgencies in the western provinces, the Xinjiang province and the Uyghur Autonomous Region, where you have a large Muslim population. And there, what are they doing? They're supporting Al-Qaeda-affiliated organizations, which are essentially, under the helm of the CIA, creating terrorist events and so on and so forth. So there is that kind of inroad, and there's also and there has been for a very long time, I can say for a very long time, there has been a plan on the drawing board to fragment China, to cut China into different republics, so to speak, particularly South China, North China, Tibet, the western provinces, and so on. So that option has been there. And that option is very similar to what they've been trying to do in the Middle East, but they're dealing with a very different polity and social reality and also a misunderstanding of Chinese history going back to the Ming Dynasty. So there we are. That is the groundwork, is that now what is at stake is essentially to curb the Chinese tiger, so to speak, is that the Chinese economy has served the Western market economy for the last 30 or more years, since the early 80s. And now what Western leaders want to do is to ensure that tiger does not accede to the status of a global capitalist entity, which would challenge the hegemony of the United States and Western Europe and so on. And the thing is, of course, from a military standpoint, China is a nuclear power. It has a very advanced weapon system, and it has been developing that weapon system very carefully together with its Russian ally, and that I think is another dimension of this discussion and debate, is that if there is a confrontation with either Russia or China, we're in a very dangerous situation. This could lead to a world war, but at this stage, with regard to China, I don't think that this is likely to happen. It's much more focused on Russia at this particular point. But the threats directed against China in the South China Sea, I think, are intended to weaken China's relationship to Russia. But in fact, as you pointed out, that may in fact do exactly the opposite. It will reinforce the military alliance between Russia and China.
For more on this story and other breaking news and current events, please go to globalresearch.ca. For more research and analysis by James Corbett, please go to corbettreport.com.